So thanks. It's a great pleasure to have this opportunity to say something about the emergence of space and time. I think it connects quite nicely to the previous speaker. This is a quite complicated subject to cover in 30 minutes or so. So I'll give a particular perspective. There will be very few references. It's all impossible to squeeze all of that in 25 minutes. But let me just try to sketch the main problem in trying to think about space and time. So as we know very well, in general relativity, the geometry of space and time are dynamical. This was beautifully illustrated with the recent measurement of gravitational waves, which really detect ripples that propagate to space and time. However, we also know that what causes those gravitational waves is matter. Big lumps of matter, otherwise you don't get proper gravitational waves. But we also know that matter, at a fundamental level, is quantum. It's the laws of quantum mechanics that describe matter at a shorter distance scale. And if matter is the thing that makes space and time wiggle, and if matter at a fundamental short distance scale is quantum mechanical and described by a wave function with probabilities, then space-time itself must be sensitive to those probabilities, and in some sense, space-time itself must be something quantum as well. That means that if you were to go to the shortest possible distances, space and time would become a total mess. It would be some quantum probabilistic soup. And it's impossible here to have, and you should think of this as not being something static, but you should think of this as some sort of complicated wave function that gives probability distributions for different types of shapes and so on of space and time. And it's very difficult to even think of a formalism to describe this. The main problem here is that there's no good frame of reference. What we're looking at here is not small ripples on a fixed geometry of space and time. There's even the topology has changed. So how do we even develop a language to describe such types of spaces and times? It's not even clear what a good starting point is. So this is the main struggle in trying to combine quantum mechanics with general relativity, is to think of a good formalism, a good language, to describe space and time that by themselves have no intrinsic meaning. They're all part of a big quantum soup. So how do you even start describing such a mess? So one idea, which turns out to be very successful, is to put gravity in an imaginary box. There is a particular type of box that we can put gravity in, which has the nice feature that as you go towards the boundaries of the box, quantum fluctuations are suppressed. And as you go all the way sort of to the end point of the box, quantum fluctuations become small and they decay to zero. That means that once you go all the way to the boundary of this box here, because there is no longer any quantum fluctuation left, space and time become well defined again. And this allows us to have at the boundary of the box a well-defined notion of space and time, which we can use as sort of a frame of reference to try to describe the complicated quantum fluctuations that happen in the interior of space and time. Now, what does this box look like? I will have very few equations, but for those of you who know a little bit of general relativity, this is the geometry that describes the box. We can make the box as large as we want, and in the middle of the box here, it's pretty much just flat space. You should think of this box as the boundaries of the box as being very, very far away. So this is an excellent approximation to quantum gravity and flat space in the middle of the box. But what you see here is that you should think of this coordinate r as the size of the box, that as you go towards the boundaries of the box, there is some exponentially growing factor here. And this exponentially growing factor here is the thing that makes these quantum fluctuations decay as you go towards the boundary. And that's why at the boundary we have a nicely well-defined notion of space and time. And this particular space-time has a name. It's called anti-de Sitter space for some weird historical reason. Because it was written down by de Sitter and he was not anti-de space or anything, so it's not exactly clear. I'm not even sure historically who came up with this name. But anyway, it's just a very simple geometry. And by using this box, and it's quite standard in physics to put things in a box, for example, if you want to regulate the infrared behavior. So in some sense, we're doing something similar here, but now in the gravitational setting. And now we can try to use the well-defined notions of space and time at the boundary to sort of describe what's going on in the interior. This is the frame of reference that this box gives us. Now, since space and time on the boundary here are well defined, you might imagine that perhaps a more conventional system lives there. Maybe it's something that looks more like a standard quantum mechanical system, which employs a well-defined notion of space and time. But that would be maybe a bit weird, because if you think about it, this boundary has one dimension less than all of space and time, right? It's the boundary of space-time. So how is it possible to describe gravity in terms of things that only live on the boundary? Aren't we missing things if we try to describe everything of things that live on the boundary? But in fact, we don't miss anything, because this is more of a feature. It's not a bug, it's a feature. And one reason why this is an important feature is that that's a fact which is not very often emphasized. But in fact, the Hamiltonian, the H of the previous talk, in general relativity is equal to zero. There is, in some, it might sound strange, because clearly if you look at gravitational waves, things are moving and isn't there energy floating around? Yes, there is. But everything that happens can be described purely in terms of what happens at the boundary. This is not entirely dissimilar from what you have in electromagnetism, where the charges of a system can be measured at infinity. You just use Gauss's law to measure the charge at infinity. And somewhat similarly, it's always true that when you have an underlying gauge symmetry, that the corresponding conserved charge is always measured at infinity. That means that all the dynamics of general relativity can in fact be captured by things that only happen at the boundary, because that's the only place where you have a non-trivial contribution to the Hamiltonian. A second reason why it's not so crazy to put maybe a conventional quantum mechanical system on the boundary and try to use that to describe all of the interior is because there is a famous equation, the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy formula, which says that there is a bound on the number of degrees of freedom in gravity that you can put in a certain region. And the number of degrees of freedom that you can put in a certain region is proportional to the area, not the volume. That shows you that gravity by itself is not an extensive theory. If gravity were an extensive theory, then thermodynamic quantities like the entropy and so on, they would scale with the volume and not with the area. But there's a lot of like theoretical evidence that the entropy of a black hole, which is the maximum amount of information you can store in a certain region, scales as the area, not as the volume. And this is not extensive. But this has precisely one dimension less than the volume. And that's why you might hope to describe all these degrees of freedom in terms of a local, extensive, more conventional quantum mechanical system, which lives in one dimension less, which is precisely the thing that sits at this boundary here. Now, suppose now that indeed on this boundary we can there is some sort of standard conventional quantum mechanical system that captures all the information that goes on in the interior of this box. What properties would this imaginary quantum mechanical system need to have in order for this to be feasible? Well, we can think of a few things that must happen. So first of all, suppose there is something like a standard free field living on this boundary. A free field is typically described as something like a Klein-Gordon equation. Now, if we had such a free field living at this boundary and it would obey this differential equation, it's quite hard to see how this would correspond to something that propagates in one dimension higher. Because the field equations that describe things that propagate in gravity also look like this differential equation, but they have one extra coordinate. So this can never describe sort of a field equation in one dimension higher in a nice easy way. And the way around this is that we should not base our field theory on simple weakly coupled free fields. What we should think of is a very complicated, strongly coupled quantum mechanical system where there is no notion of a free field, but all that you have is sort of operators in the theory, and that those operators in general do not obey any simple field equations. And this is an argument why, if this picture can make sense, if it does make sense, this is an argument why this theory that sits at the boundary of this box must be a very complicated, strongly coupled quantum mechanical system. So that's one ingredient. A second ingredient that this hypothetical quantum mechanical theory must have, that lives on the boundary of this box, is that it must have an incredibly large number of degrees of freedom. We can see that by again looking at the entropy of a black hole. The entropy of a black hole scales like it's a mass squared roughly divided by the Newton constant. Now if this mass here, which is sort of the energy of the black hole, if that's is the same as the energy in this quantum mechanical system, then we see that at fixed energy we can have an arbitrarily large entropy if we make the Newton constant small, and it is quite small in nature. But here we treat it as a free parameter. So in the limit where this Newton constant becomes very small, we see that the number of degrees of freedom that you must have at a given energy goes to infinity. And the only way to do that is somehow to have a field theory that has a ridiculously large number of degrees of freedom. So that's a second requirement that we should impose on this field theory on the boundary of the box. Let me skip that one. And another criterion that we should impose is that if you look at the theory of gravity, there are not that many degrees of freedom going on. We have maybe the fields of the standard model and so on, and then there's gravity itself. But there's not a large number of stuff going on in this box. That suggests that we should not have too many operators at low energies in the theory, because we simply don't have too many fields, light fields, in gravity. So another requirement that we must impose on this hypothetical quantum mechanical theory that lives at the boundary of this box is that it should have only a few simple low energy operators. And then the final requirement is, if we just look at the geometry of the box, I'm writing this geometry again here, one can see that this geometry has a very simple symmetry, and that symmetry tells you that if you rescale time and space, this geometry does not change. And this means that the theory that lives on the boundary of this box must be a scale invariant theory. It must be invariant under rescalings of space and time. So if this picture makes sense at all, we have a whole wish list of criteria that this hypothetical theory, this hypothetical quantum mechanical theory on the boundary must satisfy. These are very strange quantum mechanical systems that are not very familiar. Do such quantum mechanical systems exist? And yes, they do exist. In fact, some explicit examples of such quantum mechanical systems were originally found in the context of string theory, and they were part of something which is called the ADS-CFT correspondence that was proposed by Maldacena in 1997. So we do have quantum mechanical systems that obey all these criteria, and therefore we now have a situation that we have a very complicated quantum mechanical system. It is defined at the boundary of this box, and it describes all the gravitational interactions that are going on inside the box. And now with this tool we can ask, what do we now learn about time and space inside this box? Yeah, on the boundary of the box, time and space are unambiguous, but you can ask what we now learn about time and space inside the box. Well, one interesting thing is, you can work out this map, this relationship between gravity in this box and this quantum system on the boundary of the box in some more detail. And one thing that you find is that correlation functions in this theory at the boundary can be related to something that looks like Feynman diagrams in gravity. It basically is a bunch of Green's functions, maybe with some interactions. So the way we sort of study gravity using this theory at the boundary is very much in the spirit of medical imaging. We put some sources on the outside and we know the response of the inside to those perturbations on the outside, and then we have to do some sort of inverse whatever transform to try to figure out what's going on the inside. But that's technology that exists, and in that way we can reconstruct, for example, the Einstein field equations from purely data that is contained in this quantum mechanical system at the boundary. However, what is the type of emergence that is going on here? So we have a very complicated quantum mechanical system, and if we had this given to us by itself, without knowing that it had any relationship to gravity whatsoever, we might have discovered that if we computed correlation functions in this complicated, strongly coupled quantum system, we might have discovered that it has a very convenient reinterpretation in terms of gravity, in terms of gravitational computations. And according to one of the definitions of emergence, this would allow us to call time and space emergent, because it's a description that emerges in some corner of parameter space. But there are many problems with this whole setup, because first of all, these quantum mechanical systems are so complicated that typically we have no independent way to compute anything. We could try to stick them in a computer or something like that, but in general it's quite hard to compute anything. One beautiful aspect of this whole duality, or this reinterpretation of gravity in terms of a quantum mechanical system that lives at the boundary of this box, is that there is now a very nice interpretation of black holes. It turns out that if you put a black hole in this box, so in the gravitational theory in this box, and you look at what happens at the boundary of the box, then the description in terms of this quantum mechanical system is simply that the quantum mechanical system becomes a system at finite temperature. So we have some equivalence between the physics of a black hole, which looks like a classical geometrical configuration, and a field theory at finite temperature, which could be described by statistical mechanics or even hydrodynamics. And this can be developed in quite a bit of detail. For example, you can explicitly show that if you take a black hole and you look at the Einstein equations near a black hole, you can fool around with these Einstein equations and you can extract the equations of hydrodynamics from them. And those are precisely the equations that describe the hydrodynamic behavior of the field theory at finite temperature, which is quite a remarkable confirmation of this statement. And many basic black hole physics can be translated into sort of statistical thermodynamical words. For example, if you fall into a black hole, then you're just perturbing a finite temperature system. And what happens typically if you perturb a finite temperature system, you will just dissipate into this finite temperature system. So falling into a black hole is like dissipation. Creating a black hole out of nothing by collapsing some matter is a process which in field theory or in quantum mechanics we call thermalization. We start with a system which is out of equilibrium and then we let it equilibrate and the system thermalizes. Now it's interesting that these remarkable quantum systems that play a role here, look at the translation between what gravity tells you and what you think is happening in the field theory, then from gravity, and we have no independent way to compute this in these quantum mechanical systems, but using this gravitational description of these systems, we see that this quantum field theory must have many interesting properties. For example, one can show that the hydrodynamics of this finite temperature stuff must have a very low viscosity that follows from looking at gravity. You can see that if you quench the system, so you put some energy into the system, that because black holes form very fast, that translates into a system that in these quantum systems thermalization is very fast. It's probably as fast as possible in any physical system. And a third observation, which you can again derive by looking at the gravitational description, is that the quantum field theory, the quantum system, should be maximally chaotic. You cannot have a more quantum chaotic system than these kind of weird quantum theories that play a role here. So they really are quite remarkable quantum mechanical systems. Let me check how the time is working. How much longer do I have? 5 minutes. Very good. Very well. Then I should briefly say something about the role of quantum information, because one of the interesting new tools that we have now to study the relationship between these quantum systems and gravity employs quantum information techniques. I don't have time to say anything in detail, but the most important thing that plays a role is the notion of quantum entanglement. And the prototype example of an entangled system is just a bell pair where we have a coherent superposition of, say, two spins down and two spins up. And what entanglement does for you, it makes sure that if you do measurements in two different systems, and if these two different systems are entangled, then the outcomes of these measurements are correlated. That's not something you have in classical systems, but in quantum systems, this is possible due to quantum entanglement. And we very often use some sort of quantity that's called entanglement entropy, that basically tells you how many, roughly speaking, how many bell pairs you have that are shared between a system A and a system B. And it turns out that there is a very nice gravitational interpretation of the amount of entanglement that lives in this quantum mechanical system on the boundary. And the proposal is as follows. Suppose you separate the boundary, which is represented here by this green sheet, suppose you represent it into two spatial regions, A and B, and you ask in this quantum mechanical system how many bell pairs are there shared between A and B. It turns out that what you have to do is you have to sort of build a minimal surface, a surface with the smallest possible area that connects to the boundary between A and B. And it turns out in this whole story that the number of bell pairs between A and B is directly related to the area of this minimal surface divided by the Newton constant. So that's a direct relation between a complicated quantum mechanical notion of entanglement and a classical geometrical notion. And this shows you already that there is a very close interplay between quantum mechanical things like entanglement and classical things like geometry. And this whole dictionary can be developed much further. It turns out that that we can make somewhat precise statements about the extent to which spaces are connected and the amount of entanglement there is between spaces. If you would have two systems that have no entanglement whatsoever, then and you express them in terms of gravity, they also will be disconnected, etc. And the more entanglement there is, the more connected they become, the bigger the geometry is that connects the two. There's a whole laundry list of quantum information theoretical things that seem to play a role in gravity for some mysterious reason, which has led to the suggestion that perhaps we should reformulate gravity entirely in quantum information theoretic terms. But this has not been achieved yet, but it's an interesting idea. And then to wrap up, I want to emphasize some properties of these quantum mechanical systems, because they're very interesting in their own right. So what happens to these quantum mechanical systems is the following. I already told you they have a large number of degrees of freedom, and they're strongly coupled. And if we look at the known explicit examples of these quantum mechanical systems, they have the property that if they're at weak coupling, where we have standard ways like perturbation theory and so to compute things, the spectrum is kind of evenly distributed. But something remarkable happens to the spectrum of these theories as you increase the coupling constant of these theories. Because almost all the states that had low energies at weak coupling run away. They all acquire very large energies at strong coupling, and only a handful of light states remain. And it's very hard to cook up theories that have this feature. But this is the important reason why at strong coupling this system can be described by gravity. These low-lying states, they are sort of the ripples that live on space-time. And these incredibly dense high-energy states, those are the things that make up black holes. And that's an interesting picture at strong coupling, and it's a highly non-trivial prediction that one gets from this work. So the picture is as follows. conventional gravitational physics, just looking at some particles that propagate through a space-time and so on, it's all described in terms of the low-lying part of the spectrum. Once you form a black hole, you start to access these very complicated high-energy degrees of freedom. These low-lying degrees of freedom, they're all local from a gravity point of view. They just are little wave packets that propagate through space-time. But you can prove that these high energy degrees of freedom, they are very non-local. They're very strange. We don't even know how to describe them very well. But in any case, they're individually not accessible to us as low energy observers. The only thing we will ever see is a thermodynamic average of many of these states. We will never see an individual state here. And that's why, for all practical purposes, it does not bother us that maybe all these things are non-local, because once we average over a bunch of those, it will start to become approximately local again. And so if you wanted to describe what happens to an observer that falls into a black hole, it's some sort of interaction between these low energy degrees of freedom that describe the observer and the high energy degrees of freedom that describe the black hole. So this is very much like maybe in hydrodynamics, where you have the interaction between a wave on the fluid with the underlying microscopic degrees of freedom. And it's interesting that the fact that these things are non-local is precisely the sort of thing that allows you to let information escape from the black hole. There is something called the information loss paradox, which remains a subject of debate, but in this picture, the fact that we have all these non-local high energy degrees of freedom is precisely what allows information to come out of the black hole. So, if you want, in physics, when we try to study the real world, there's different possible approaches. Very often we start with free field theory and we do perturbation theory of weakly coupled particles. An interesting alternative approach is to not start with something free but something solvable, an exactly integrable system. But the real world is not exactly integrable, so we can try to approach it from this direction. Then there's lattice and numerical methods, but now we have a third box here, which is this weird class of quantum mechanical systems that have a gravitational dual. And they're different from these two boxes, and we can also try to approach the real world from this corner. And now, if you look at a particular physics problem, the question is whether it's better to approach it from this side, or from this side. And it's quite conceivable that the systems that have these gravitational duals are close, are an interesting universality class that is close to a large class of interesting physics problems. For example, they seem to be relatively close to strange metals and the things that make up high-TC superconductors, and they are relatively close to complicated systems like the quark-gluon plasma, and the evidence for that is precisely in these funny features that were uncovered in this whole story. And I think I'm out of time, but I think I already said that, because this was about emergence, that at low energies you can debate whether this is emergence, but there is a huge difference in this story about the nature of the emergence at low and at high energies. At low energies, it's emergence because we're in a different corner of parameter space. At high energies, it's emergence because we're coarse graining over microscopic degrees of freedom and looking at some sort of hydrodynamic effect of field theory. I'll stop now. Thank you.